The Satyricon by Petronius. Read by Jonathan Keeble for Naxos Audiobooks. Part 1. The Adventures of Encolpius and His Companions. It has been so long since I promised you the story of my adventures that I have decided to make good my word today, and, seeing that we have thus fortunately met, not to discuss scientific matters alone, but also to enliven our jolly conversation with witty stories. Fabricius Viento has already spoken very cleverly on the errors committed in the name of religion, and shown how priests, animated by a hypocritical mania for prophecy, boldly expound mysteries which are too often such to themselves. But are our rhetoricians tormented by another species of furies when they cry, "I received these wounds while fighting for the public liberty. I lost this eye in your defence. Give me a guide who will lead me to my children. My limbs are hamstrung and will not hold me up." Even these heroics could be endured if they made easier the road to eloquence. But as it is, their sole gain from this ferment of matter and empty discord of words is that when they step into the forum, they think they have been carried into another world. And it is my conviction that the schools are responsible for the gross foolishness of our young men, because in them they see or hear nothing at all of the affairs of everyday life, but only pirates standing in chains upon the shore, tyrants scribbling edicts in which sons are ordered to behead their own fathers, responses from oracles delivered in time of pestilence, ordering the immolation of three or more virgins, every word a honeyed drop, every period sprinkled with poppy seed and sesame. Those who are brought up on such a diet can no more attain to wisdom than a kitchen scullion can attain to a keen sense of smell, or avoid stinking of the grease. With your indulgence, I will speak out. You, teachers, are chiefly responsible for the decay of oratory. With your well-modulated and empty tones, you have so laboured for rhetorical effect that the body of your speech has lost its vigour and died. Young men did not learn set speeches in the days when Sophocles and Euripides were searching for words in which to express themselves, in the days when Pindar and the 9 lyric poets feared to attempt Homeric verse. There was no private tutor to stifle budding genius. I need not cite the poets for evidence, for I do not find that either Plato or Demosthenes was given to this kind of exercise. A dignified, and, if I may say it, a chaste style, is neither elaborate nor loaded with ornament. It rises supreme by its own natural purity. This windy and high-sounding bombast, a recent immigrant to Athens from Asia, touched with its breath the aspiring minds of youth, with the effect of some pestilential planet, and as soon as the tradition of the past was broken, eloquence halted and was stricken dumb. Since that, who has attained to the sublimity of Thucydides? Who rivaled the fame of Hyperides? Not a single poem has glowed with a healthy colour, but all of them, as though nourished on the same diet, lacked the strength to live to old age. Painting also suffered the same fate when the presumption of the Egyptians commercialised that incomparable art. I was holding forth along these lines one day when Agamemnon came up to us and scanned with a curious eye a person to whom the audience was listening so closely. He would not permit me to declaim longer in the portico than he himself had sweat in the school, but exclaimed, "Your sentiments do not reflect the public taste, young man, and you are a lover of common sense, which is still more unusual. For that reason, I will not deceive you as to the secrets of my profession. The teachers, who must gibber with lunatics, are by no means to blame for these exercises. Unless they spoke in accordance with the dictates of their young pupils, they would, as Cicero remarks, be left alone in the schools. And, as designing parasites, when they seek invitations to the tables of the rich, have in mind nothing except what will, in their opinion..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.